Okay, so Rosetta also contains kind of some machinery for modeling ligands. Basically, the ligands themselves are specified to Rosetta with a parameters file, a ligand parameter file, and there's a script that can convert basically an idealized MOL2 file of a ligand into a Rosetta parameters file. So basically, to refine a structure with a ligand, you need a MOL2 file of the ligand kind of in its ideal configuration with ideal bond lengths and bond angles, and with hydrogens attached. So if you don't have this available, you can actually, there are tools for converting these. I can't talk about this. No, I don't. So there's basically tools for generating MOL2 files, and then there's tools for attaching hydrogens to these, to the ligands, so you can generate something. But ideally, it's best if you can get kind of an idealized MOL2 file. At some point in the near future, I think there's going to be tools in Rosetta for actually kind of automatically generating params files on the fly, kind of in a reasonable way. But for now, you still need to provide to Rosetta a kind of an idealized ligand file. And so then the parameters file themselves looks something like this. So it basically just is a description. This isn't important. You generally don't have to deal with these. Basically just describes all of the atoms, the ideal geometry. It describes per atom partial charges. And you can also, again, even specify rotamer libraries and things like that. The key aspect is that there's a script in Rosetta that makes this. So mol file to params basically takes a mol2 file of the ligand, including hydrogens. So a program like OpenBabel, for example, which you can freely download, will convert PDB to mol2 file. And again, like I said, ideal Rosetta geometry is generated from this file, so make sure it is reasonable. And again, the molecule needs to have hydrogen positions attached, or else the energies that are computed from this aren't reasonable. So the way the script works, like the other scripts, you can run this without command line arguments, and it tells you exactly all the command line arguments that it accepts. So for example, this heme that I'm modeling here, you can see that we provide this set of arguments. Keep names says to keep the atom names from the input file to the output file, which you probably want to do. These extra two arguments are really important if you're going to be running any of the refinement scripts. So all the refinement scripts need these extra, in addition to the params files, need extra output files. And these two flags specify that Rosetta should generate those extra output files. This is the input MOL2 file, and then you want to just give a three-letter code with dash P and dash N, a three-letter code that you're using in the PDB to identify the ligand. So it's basically the three-letter name for the ligand in Rosetta. And so then what you can basically do is for any protocol itself that uses, that I've showed so far, you can basically get it to support to understand ligands by adding these three flags to the command line. So not to the XML, but the call that you make to Rosetta scripts, you need to add these three flags to the file. So Rosetta CM, there's a little bit of extra complexity in using this, but Rosetta CM, you could do comparative modeling. Again, this model recombination, all of this stuff with ligands present as well. For Rosetta CM, there's a little extra complexity. So basically, what you need to do with Rosetta CM is you make your threaded models, right? So you run the partial thread application. You make your threaded models. Now you need to manually dock the ligand in. So you basically manually dock the ligand. So you take basically align the template to the target and manually place the ligand into the threaded model itself, and then you add this tag to hybridize. And what this tells, or excuse me, to Rosetta CM, what this tells Rosetta CM is that when it reads a template, to read all of the ligands from the template, and to then use those in modeling itself. And so when it, so basically it will then build, when it considers sampling, confidential sampling, it'll do so with the ligand position present from this file. And so again, it's important. So in addition to these three flags, to run with Rosetta CM with ligands, you can do this. And so it's shown like that. So metal binding state. So actually metals are now, at least in recent versions of Rosetta, metals are read by Rosetta, but the problem is that its force field does not properly does not really know about proper coordination geometry. And so oftentimes, it's usually reasonably well behaved, but if you really are interested in high resolution details, you need to coordinate the metal sites specifically. And so generally the way that you do this is just using constraint files. So you provide basically atom pair and angle constraints between the metal ion and the and any of the coordinating amino acids. So for example, in this case, we're showing kind of tetrahedral coordination of four cysteines around a zinc ion. You can see that we're enforcing a distance of 2.34 angstroms between the SG and the zinc, and then we're enforcing essentially 109 degrees between all pairs of zinc. And so this is one thing to note, is that when you specify angle constraints, this is specified in radians, not in degrees. I know it's really silly, but that's the way Rosetta does things. And so basically this declaration specifies coordinated tetrahedral coordination around the zinc molecule. So if you have any metal binding sites in the protein, generally you'll want to use something like this. If you're going to, when we talked about in Rosetta CM about the kind of the centroid constraints and the full atom constraints, you want to make the specification of the full atom constraints. Generally in the low resolution stage, the metal ion will be treated reasonably well. Okay. I think that's it for ligands and metals. I think there's a little more detail in the tutorial, and actually there's a lot of documentation in Rosetta on, if you look at sort of ligand modeling or mol-file de Brahms in the Rosetta documentation, there's actually quite a bit of information if you're really interested in this. So the last part that I wanted to talk about was de novo model building. Okay, so I guess just to give a little bit of motivation. So the de novo model building is essentially you have no information, no homologous high-resolution structures available. You have only a map and a sequence, and that's it. So we've developed a protocol. It works reasonably well. It's very time-consuming, very CPU-intensive, but it seems to work, I guess, in our tests reasonably well for this. And so the challenge, of course, in this case is that there exists lots of crystallography programs for building models de novo into density, but the challenge here is, of course, you have a lack of resolution for EM. And so the lack of detail in the side chains make it difficult to identify sequence. You can see here that, again, you get roughly in this 4.8 angstrom reconstruction, you can kind of see the topology of the protein even there. It's ambiguous, kind of some of these interactive loops. It's tough to tell exactly topologically how things go, but getting sequence registration is very, very difficult. And so we've developed a tool. I'm going to go through this very quickly because it's not really, this is about using the tool and not so much a scientific talk. But essentially, the way that it works is we use, again, this idea of local fragments. In this case, we use the idea, local sequence tells us something about what backbone conformations are allowed given that sequence. We can sample that information from previously solved structures. The way that it works is that we basically take for each of these fragments, we search the map for each of them, we do a six-dimensional search of the map for them. Shown, you get a number of hits for that. We actually then can follow that up with sidechain building and refinement, and we can see for each of these fragments basically where in the map they match best. So of course these are small pieces. And so they match, we're looking for a piece, looking for a fragment, we search for it in the map, we find 25 places or 50 places where it could be, we find the correct location, but because this is such a small piece, we find a number of other incorrect locations. Where it could be. Yes?
What if there's some region that density doesn't show up and the sequence still there?
It handles that basically. So I don't know if I talk about it here. It handles that though. So basically what happens is, let me go through the next couple steps and then I'll explain how it handles that. But it totally can handle that. It's fine. In fact, one of the cases that we solved, we didn't know. We were searching for 200 residues and we had a 400 residue window of sequence. And so we just ran with the whole 400 residue and we found out which 200 were there. So the challenge is now for each of these places, we find where in the map it could possibly be. Of course, it finds a right location and many wrong locations. So how do we pull these right, correct locations out from the map? And so the idea there is that we do this consistency check. So we find basically the largest set of fragments that we can, largest set of placed fragments that we can that are consistent with the data. And by consistency, we just mean very, very simple. We do this, if you remember, we do this with overlapping fragments. as I've shown here. If a fragment assigns the same residue, it has to assign it to the same place. If you have two different placements that assign the same residue to different places, that's inconsistent. There's a huge penalty. Residues close in sequence space have to be close in three-dimensional space. If you put residue 10 over here and residue 12 over here, that doesn't make any sense. That's inconsistent. And then finally, no two residues can occupy the same space. So you can't, just a simple sterics, you can't put two things in the same location. Okay, so we developed essentially a score function. You can ignore the stuff on the bottom. We basically have a score function. So F here is a fragment assignment of fragments to the data. So it's basically at each position, we find a number of different locations in the map. We now, for each position, just see the next slide here. No, I don't. So for each position, we either assign a fragment or assign no fragment, basically. That kind of answers your question. At some positions, we either don't, either they're not visible in the map, or we maybe don't have a fragment that accurately characterizes them. And so when we do that, basically the fragment assignment is only over a subset of positions do we actually assign a fragment. And so then we compute basically the sum of density scores of all the fragments that we placed, plus these three consistency measures that I talked about, that are basically zero if the models are consistent, and it's a very high energy if the model, if the pairs of fragments are inconsistent with one another. Exact functional form is here, it doesn't matter. But then basically we have an energy function, and so we can do Monte Carlo sampling of that placement. So we do Monte Carlo sampling where we assign to each position in the protein, we assign either one of the placed fragments or a null placement where we say we don't know where this piece is. We then do a long Monte Carlo trajectory where we just pick random positions and flip the fragments that we assign, pre-compute everything so it's really run, so we can run for tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands of steps in a relatively short amount of time, and we get something that looks like this. This is a case where we know the answer. X-axis is the accuracy, y-axis is the score, and you can see these are each of these dots is an individual trajectory. You can see that it converges very well to a very low energy state that's accurate. We get 90% of the model covered, assigned correctly, and with 100% accuracy. This is probably too excessive. So anyway, yeah. So basically what happens is when it can't find it, I'll tell you exactly where. So when it can't find things, I glossed over this because I didn't want to give the full scientific talk. So essentially what happens is when you run, so this is a different case, when you run, right, ultimately you get a bunch of Monte Carlo. So this is the, again, it's accuracy, we know the answer. This is the score, and this, each of these dots is a Monte Carlo trajectory. You run 10,000 trajectories, typically for this. And then what we do is we look for the consensus of the best 5% of trajectories that we discover. And so this doesn't look like 10,000 dots, but that's because it converges pretty heavily. So each of these dots is actually, you know, dozens to hundreds of dots on top of one another. So where it breaks down at low resolution is that there's a kind of a broad basin here. And so we look for consensus. So for all these low energy states, we look for the things that they all assign the same. At low resolution, generally that fails. And so you get zero consensus. So when you look for your consensus, there's nothing. You have 10 low energy models, and none of them have anything in common with one another. So that's where. So this is actually nice in that it usually, when it fails, it kind of does so gracefully by saying, I don't know the answer to this. And in fact, you can see that. So kind of graphically, this is what it looks like, right? Because this is kind of a graphic representation. Again, a case where we know the answer. X-axis walks along the sequence, y-axis is the error of each placed fragment. These are each of the 50 plate things that we placed in the density map. And you can see the assembly, if we look at the consensus on this case, we're able to pick out many of these low energy states. Excuse me, many of these low RMS states. So we can do this, we can iterate this basically is what I'm showing here. We benchmarked this and it works pretty well. We tested this on 9 different maps and it worked pretty well on 6 of the maps as well, and in fact, one of the cases where it failed, you can see that we do get, so you see basically we get lower, to answer your question again, we get lower coverage, right? This is the percentage of coverage of the model, and this is after iterating it. Here we actually get a very active model, it just doesn't cover very much at all, the rest of the structure doesn't converge, And actually, in these two models, we get very accurate models after the first round. And it's only in subsequent rounds that we start putting inaccurate. In fact, we get very good models. They just cover only 10 or 15% of the model.
Does the secondary structure make a difference? Like you have helices or beta strands or?
Yeah, so in terms of the approach, it tends to work better with helical structures, yes. Although we do, I mean, you can see examples here. So again, these are two of the cases, again, that we ran this on. And then using Rosetta CM, we can easily complete these models, basically. These are two of the cases. It tends to work better for helical structures. It can handle sheets. All beta proteins are a little difficult. Okay, so now let's talk about actually if you wanted to run this. So the other stuff that I showed is through Rosetta scripts. Unfortunately, due to the kind of more complicated job distribution, this is actually done through a separate application called the novo density that I've shown here. So what I've shown basically is there's four steps to the protocol. So it's divided into four different tasks. And so this app does all four tasks separately, but basically one at a time using this mode flag. And the reason for that is essentially, so this shows the protocol. You place the model, so that's the docking the individual fragments into density. You score the models, so you compute all pairwise all fragments, what their energy is. You assemble the models, and that's actually doing these Monte Carlo trajectories. And then finally, consensus assembles the consensus. So it takes these 10,000 Monte Carlo trajectories, it does an energy cut and figures out what the low energy models are. So the tutorial itself, this tutorial four now, the scenario four, walks you through all of this with an example case, gives example inputs, example fragment files, etc. The reason for splitting this up in this way is generally this step and this step you want to run in parallel, right? Need to be parallelized, whereas this step and this step are very, very quick. And so it's kind of split up so you can run the first and third step on sort of a cluster or on, you know, using whatever job distribution system that you have. Whereas the second and the fourth step, you can just run on a desktop machine, whatever analysis machine that you're using. All right, so I just wanted to give a couple of, I forget how much detail I give for this algorithm, but I just wanted to talk a little bit about preparing inputs. So currently, we can't handle symmetry. The Novo building only works over an asymmetric unit, so the map has to be trimmed over the asymmetric unit. Because it can handle missing density pretty cleanly, it's all right to sort of small trimming errors in the model itself. So that's not problematic. And again, cases that we've solved with this where we didn't know the answer, we trimmed manually and didn't do a great job, and it still seems to work pretty well. The sequence itself, you should try to omit disordered termini when you can. It works better. The less sequence that you have, that you're searching for, the better it converges. And finally, it works best with maps of better than 4 angstroms and all alpha or mixed alpha beta topology. It doesn't mean it won't work if that doesn't hold, but rather that this is sort of the highest indicator of success for this approach. So the first step again is this de novo placement. This is the part where we're characterizing fragments for each of these 9 residue overlapping windows. We're searching the density map for them, and we again find all the possible locations that each fragment could be. All right, so the command line for this is a little bit more complicated because there's no XML. Part of it is most of these, again, you're seeing a lot of arguments. Most of them are default, but I'm putting them there in case, so it's clear in case you wanted to use them yourself. So you need to, for the novo density, you're first just placing fragments into density. So you give it your input FASTA file, and you give it a fragment file. Okay, and so this actually contains these computed fragments. And so for this, we actually use Rosetta, so the online Rosetta server, to generate the fragment libraries themselves in this case. So for the other applications that I described, we use fragments as well, but they're computed on the fly. In this case, the more accurate fragments that are, again, resulting from Rosetta actually improve things quite a bit. So yeah, and then the rest of the arguments, should I go through this? Oh yeah, so I do go through this. Okay, so basically, if you want to get a fragment file, you can go to the Rosetta server. Underneath, there's a fragment libraries tab, and you click submit. And then you basically type in your target name and then paste the fast. And if you're just building fragments and you're not asking for a prediction, this should be relatively quick. And at some point in the near future, we will have some of that logic in the de novo building. Okay, so there are a lot of flags. I'm going to walk through kind of the important ones. So first of all, kind of this is the scale of the search itself, this end of search and filtered. So basically, what does this say? So this says basically, the first number says how many translations do we actually consider. So the way it does is it basically does this basically a fast rotation function. So it finds a number of translations where it does this search, uses this fast rotation function to very quickly search over a single translation. And so the first number is how many translations do we consider, and the second number is how many models ultimately after the 60 search, how many models progress into refinement. There's a really rough rule of thumb we have for this, 20 times and 10 times respectively the number of residues, but keep in mind the basically the runtime scales with each of these parameters linearly. So doubling end to search and doubling end filters doubles your runtime, essentially. And so if you have really good data, sometimes it's worth trying with a very low end to search and very low end filtered first. Let things run really quickly, and if that converges to something, then great, you're done. Otherwise, you can go to a more extensive search. So that's why that's listed. But again, rough rule of thumb, if you have absence of any other information, rough rule of thumb seems to work. Position is lets you do the position at which to search. And so basically you have a 400 residue protein. If you do -pos 7, it'll search at residue 7. So all the fragments starting at residue 7, it'll search for. And this is basically the way that parallelization is carried out, or at least recommended to be carried out. Because each job takes, medium-sized protein takes about 30 minutes. So a single position, all the fragments take about 30 minutes to search. And so you generally want to parallelize this at the level of fragment placements. Excuse me, parallelize at the level of positions. For 200 residue protein, you start 200 jobs, each starting at one position, each searching over one position. Now, there's a couple of other. So if you actually look at the tutorial, again, I show some examples of command lines on how to parallelize this with GNU parallel. So it makes it very, very straightforward if you have just even one or two machines to launch a bunch of jobs. Okay, so then the other options are, if you have a C-alpha model, you can provide that C-alpha model. So for example, suppose you're in Coop and you badly built a model, and you know it was relatively straightforward to build this poly-A model, but now you want to register that model to sequence. So this flag will let you pass in this pre-built model. It doesn't force the model that you built, and it often will. If you built three residues in a loop, it may very well build four residues in that loop. But it'll use those positions as sort of seeds for the rotational search itself. This will often speed things up very, very significantly because it skips the end of search and basically replaces that with the C alphas from your model. And so basically what you're saying is when you're searching for 200, in this case, I guess 250 residue protein. Here you're doing 5,000 rotational searches. Here you're doing however many C alphas are in this backbone.pdb model. So oftentimes using this will significantly speed things up. Of course, obviously you have to have a reasonably accurate backbone model. Start model, on the other hand, is if you have a partial model and you want to build the rest of it, you can use this tool to do that. Excuse me. Oh. And so that's the way iteratively that it works, that you build a model, and then the model from the first round becomes the start model for the second round. All right, so the second step is the fragment scoring. So we separate this out, the scoring and the assembly. We separate this out because we can pre-compute the scoring. So rather than have kind of each time we do this Monte Carlo trajectory scoring things on the fly, we compute kind of all fragment pairs, their score, in advance. So then when we, in the assembly, it's just looking numbers up in a table rather than actually calculating these functions. So the way that that's done, it's a relatively simple command line now. you give a dash mode score here. The input, so I should mention, and I showed this on the earlier slide, but essentially the output from each round is the input from the subsequent rounds. So here you're seeing, again, we're doing this over every single position. So in this case, it's a script where you give it an argument that tells it the position to work on, and then it writes it to a file that is tagged with the position that it works on. And this is, again, it writes it to basically a compact representation, a silent file, which is a compact representation of all of the placed fragments and stuff. So in this case, your input now is the output from that previous step. So you run the search over all the positions. Now you run this case. The output of this is a single score file, and you can do, kind of give it whatever name you want. That ends up being input for the next two steps. And then finally, end match is 50. You can just leave at that. That's basically saying how far down the list. So for each position, you have a bunch of matches. End match is 50 says how far down the list you go. 50 generally works. It's pretty fast. You don't need to parallelize this. It runs, even on really big proteins at worst, maybe like 10 minutes. Yep, and then this output from the previous step or inputs from this step, and this is then the output from this step. Just a binary blob that contains all the scores. Okay, so the next step is the Monte Carlo assembly. So now at this point, we've docked everything into the map. We've computed all pairwise scores. Now we want to run the Monte Carlo assembly. So find the fragment subset that minimizes our total energy at this point. We do this with Monte Carlo sampling. As I mentioned, we're assigning a placed fragment or no fragment at each position. The Monte Carlo, because we pre-compute all the scores, we can run for 100,000 steps in very, very little time. This step is actually quite quick as well, but you can see, again, like I mentioned, you're assigning a fragment or a null fragment at each position. And so to run this, give it the command argument that's shown here. So again, all of these files I should mention, by the way, are in this fourth tutorial, and I would say if you're really interested in running this to work through that and see how well things are behaved. But basically, to run the assembly, you run with mode assemble. Again, instruct 5. You need to give it all of the outputs from both round 1. So this is the output from round 1. This is the output from round 2. This step needs both of those. Again, assembly weight, null weight, you can just leave these at these values. Probably shouldn't have put these in here at all, but they kind of can change how the different terms are weighed with respect to one another. The output files are shown here. And so let me see. So they're basically output from step 1, output from step 2, and then it writes these assembled files here. So we found that you generally want to run 10,000 trajectories, generate 10,000 trajectories, at this stage. And so to do this, so this step is pretty fast. So one trajectory often takes 15 to 20 seconds, very, very quick. But what we found, again, if you're doing 10,000, that can be relatively time significant. So this command line here, basically we launch, allows us to build 5 trajectories per job. And then here we can just launch now 2,000 jobs, each generating 5 trajectories in this case. And so, if we do something like that, then it's very, very quick to parallelize things. But actually, you can probably get away not parallelizing and building slightly fewer models in this case. As I mentioned, the tutorial describes how you can use parallel to launch these sorts of jobs as well. Okay, and so finally, the consensus assembly that I've shown here. So at this point, we've now generated a bunch of files assembled .1 to 2000. Each of them have the results of 5 trajectories in there. And so the last step is, of course, getting the consensus assembly. So the consensus assembly, we look at all the trajectories. We take the lowest 5% by energy, and they all kind of vote. And only positions that every single trajectory voted for do we keep at this point. So it only looks, we take this cut, and we only keep the residues that have been placed that were placed in the same position in every single trajectory. Yeah, so I'm showing that. This is, again, relatively easy, relatively fast to run. Mode consensus is here. It's the fourth step. Again, you have to give it, so you basically give it the output from step three, these assembled star files. And there's two arguments. Again, these are, you probably want to keep them from the, in the default. Basically, consensus fraction is what, like I said, 1.0 means every single low energy trajectory has to have placed something to keep it. And this energy cut 0.05 is saying what percent of models to keep. Keep the bottom 5%. Basically lowering this, I guess one of the reasons I put this here, lowering this value a little bit, especially lowering it to like 0.01, you basically allows you to see, so suppose you do your energy cut 0.05 and you get very few residues. Lowering this value will oftentimes let you produce a more complete model, but it's more likely to have errors. If you want to inspect manually what Rosetta has done with this, you can actually use that energy cut variable. All right, so now, I didn't mention this too, the output of this step is going to be just a PDB file that has your consensus assignment in it. So there's a couple of things you can do. So first of all, here's how to actually interpret the results and whether or not the approach has succeeded or not. So we treat success that at least 70% of the protein has been placed. And so in all of the cases that we found 70% of the protein can be placed, we've never seen an error, at least in our estimate. In difficult cases, you do sometimes need to apply this iteratively. So you basically, the model that the last step produces here, you then basically take that model and give it as to the first part, you give it to the first step, you go back to the first step and give it as start model with the start.pdb and rerun this, just rerun the whole process again. And the more that you complete in this model, the quicker then each subsequent step is going to go as well. Okay, so in cases where less than 70% convergence is achieved, there's still sometimes meaningful info. And in fact, empirically, by looking at a lot of cases, so again, following this paper, we've looked at a large number of cases that are recently deposited. And what we found is that generally in the first round of modeling, or in the de novo modeling, if it builds a stretch of 20 or more residues, almost always those stretches are correct. And in fact, one thing you can try, if even after multiple rounds, you're unable to be successful, a lot of times removing short segments, removing anything less than 20 residues that were placed, and then rerunning again, oftentimes it will enable completion. So, yeah.
Can you use partial models to kind of refine the data, like similar to like using homology models for phasing process structures? Can you do something like that?
Yeah, I mean,
is that possible?
I think it's, in theory, it's possible. It's not clear. I think the model bias problem becomes a lot worse with that. And so it's sort of an open question, I would say, if you could actually make use of that. It's not clear how much, I guess it's not. Yeah, I mean, you could. It's an open question, I guess, is what I would say. Okay, so another thing, looking at a ton of cases since we've published this, there's a couple of other tricks that you can try. If it fails and you're pretty sure, again, it's going to give an all helical or alpha beta protein, and it's relatively small, there's a few more things you can do. One, you can just more aggressively, if you manually trimmed an asymmetric unit, more aggressively trimming the asymmetric unit. So being more aggressive, trimming away things that aren't in the asymmetric, trimming away things that are in the asymmetric unit is worse than leaving things that aren't in the asymmetric unit. You can also do kind of subdivide the search as well. So instead of searching for the full sequence, search for subsequences. And the cool part is you actually don't need to rerun matching when you do this. The reason for that is you're basically, again, in step two, so matching is the really super computationally intensive part. So one thing you could try, you do this, again, you have a 400 residue sequence, you're searching for in a map, you run the matching and it doesn't find anything, or it doesn't find anything longer than 20 residues. So then what you can try is basically, start from step two, but only give it. So basically what you have is an input file here corresponding to each residue in the protein. So you can actually give the approach a subset of those inputs. So say you have a 400 residue protein, just give it 1 to 200, or 50 to 250, 100 to 300, and sometimes those searches will converge while the kind of full-length sequence search doesn't converge. Again, it's just a smaller space. The more residues you add, the larger the search space is, and the harder it is to find the lowest energy state. So that could definitely help. You can also try kind of breaking things up in a different way. So instead of searching smaller sequence space, you can also try searching for a smaller, basically break your map, break your asymmetric unit into multiple pieces and try searching for the full sequence in those multiple pieces as well. Again, that sort of, again, just reduces the search space. It's slightly different, but it's more that you're getting, what do I want to say? You're more likely to have a fragment placed in the correct location. Again, the larger the map is, the less likely it is that you place a fragment in the correct location. And so shrinking the map down somewhat. We're working now on tools for kind of automating this process, but they're still in progress. But just we found that these can be, in some cases, useful tricks. And you can also do, this is kind of the most painful thing, but you can do more extensive fragment searching. You can basically change the parameter and filter. This is out of date now, this move step. By default, it's one. So that's a little out of date line in here. In the tutorial, it should be set to one already. Basically increasing the parameter, both end filtered and the, covering a lot here. This, increasing both end of search and end filtered can help in some cases. There are some cases where you can get a few more positions if you double this value, and sometimes that can be enough to kind of push the search over to successful. And then also finally, I guess the last thing is this, yeah. Last thing that I want to talk about is there's kind of more dangerous things you can try. These are things that kind of increase the likelihood of the model building making an error, but can be informative at least. And it can tell you kind of what Rosetta thinks goes where. So basically, increasing the null frag score, that's one of the arguments. So basically what happens, I didn't explain this at all in good detail. Basically, like I said, we can assign a fragment at a position or we can assign nothing at a position. And so when we assign nothing, we basically get a density score. So of course, obviously, the position doesn't clash with anything else. There's no inconsistency with anything else when we assign null frag. But we don't get a density score for that position. So what the null frag score does is say when we place a null fragment, we get a score of a certain density value. And so basically, for a fragment placement to be favorable, it needs to score a little bit better than this value. Otherwise, it'll be, you know, the absence of any other data, the null frag will get placed. And so by default, this is at minus 150. We found that broadly on the test cases that we've looked at, that broadly that works pretty well. But you can imagine increasing the score to minus 130. And indeed, that'll often give you kind of a lot more complete of an alignment, or a lot more complete of a model, but it will also often have errors. And the other thing you can do is actually, like I mentioned earlier, soften what a consensus is. So when you look at the consensus alignment, it's pretty strict, right? You're doing 10,000 trajectories, you need 500 of them to all agree on a position for that position to get carried through. One thing that you could do is kind of soften this and say, all right, let's look at only the top 200, or even more dangerous, you can actually reduce this consensus frac from 100% to say 90%. So say I'll let a couple of these low energy models. Again, this will give you a more complete model, but you should definitely be more cautious with refining that model, with using those constraints. All right, and so I think I'm probably just going to end there. So again, at this time, I'm happy to, I would recommend if you're really interested in learning this, to try to at least work your way through the first couple parts of the tutorial, and I will stick around. If you have any specific questions, I'm happy to answer them at this point. Otherwise, if you're interested in getting this working on your own cases, I'm also happy to work with people on that as well. But I think that was all I was going to say. So thank you all very much. Thank you.
you have any like last questions with regards to the lecture itself? Yeah.
Right. So I'll stick around for another hour or so at least. So.
Okay. Yeah. So you guys can start a tutorial, and then as Frank said, questions you can ask.
Yeah.